As you all know, he along with three other brother judges, senior most, took this courageous action of holding a press briefing in his house, and for about, I think, about two hours or so, maybe 1.5 hours, I had never seen the entire national media focused on one person for 1.5 hours. It was like the most concentrated media attention anybody in my memory would have got.
Which destroyed my privacy.
So we all, I was also there. Actually, he did it in his lawns, and the and one of the judges today is Chief Justice of India. I personally believe that that action of Mr. Chelameswar may have contributed to the elevation of one of his brother judges over there as Chief Justice. So anyway, that aside. So I would, without much ado, I'd just like to sort of preserve time and immediately get Justice Chelameswar to talk about, since he's never spoken about what led to that great moment, which led to talk about reform in the highest judiciary. What led to that, and what happened that morning? How did it come about? It was indeed an unprecedented action, never seen before in our, at least in our Supreme Court history. He had immense support from large sections of the public, among judges and practicing lawyers, advocates. Many supported him, and some felt that maybe his action was too radical. Maybe it was something which, while it was aimed at reforming the highest judiciary, it may have sort of, in some sense, you know, been it may have overstepped the institution, may have been hurt. I think these were some of the reactions from others. But Mr. Chelameswar has taken the rough with the smooth, and here he is today. My opening question would, to him obviously would be, just tell us how it happened and how it came about.
Mr. Venu, it is not that something which happened
overnight,
or it was an impulsive decision taken. We were not children. All four of us were above 60. Of course, I'm 65 plus now. The other two are going to be 65 plus soon, one in the next month and the other one the end of December. And all of us, I held, and they are still holding, responsible offices in this country. And we were not insane people to hold that meeting. There were suddenly compelling reasons which prompted us to go and hold the press. We knew it was an unprecedented thing. Well, of course, on the light of Ween, there is a joke in the legal world. I'm sure most of you must have been familiar with, in fact, I have not read much of it except one or two. The Sherlock Holmes novels, there is a character called Watson in that. Now, there is a joke about the man. The man is so precedent-oriented that he married a widow because she has a precedence of marriage. See, this whole system has become precedent-oriented. So there were no precedent, nobody, no judge held a press conference earlier, therefore how could they do it is a question. Well, of course, it's a matter of opinion. But it was not something which happened over one day. It happened over a period of time. There are compelling reasons. Now, what exactly are the reasons? Factual details I am not going to disclose, not in the immediate future, for various reasons. But to the extent that the nation is required to know, we had already disclosed. In fact, this press conference was preceded by a letter given to the then Chief Justice almost 2.5 months prior to the event, pointing out that letter is in public domain. Then, notwithstanding the letter, a lot of things which according to us, maybe we are wrong, that's a different matter, it's a matter of opinion. I'm a Democrat. I don't quarrel opinions. My opinion might have been wrong, the opinion of my colleagues might have been wrong. That's a different story, but we believed that we are under an obligation to the nation to make that statement that day. We made it. Now, what are the individual facts which led to that? Well, that I am not going to disclose, at least in the near future. At a later point of time, before the sun sets in my life, I'll disclose it.
Okay, I'll stick to some of the facts which are already in public domain, which you have mentioned in your letter, and which subsequently you have mentioned, I think one interview that you gave Karan Thapar before, I think that was just on the eve of your...
Karan Thapar was in the month of February, if I remember, February or March.
Okay.
The last two interviews I gave, one to Mr. Rajdeep Sardeshai, that is, and NDTV Vaijanathan, that was on the 22nd, on the day I was demitting office.
Okay. So you, one takeaway, one key point that you made in your press briefing was that democracy, you said democracy was at peril.
Yeah.
Now, in what way was democracy at peril? I'm asking you this because the articulation of that, the issues at hand that day was, as many media organizations try to analyze, was they argued that it was something internal to the Supreme Court. The way probably bench shopping was happening, the way cases were being allocated, and you were focused on some of those issues particularly. But when you said democracy was at peril, one got the impression that you were talking about a much broader problem. So would you like to tell us?
I'll answer it. I'm bound to answer it, since we made that statement. And mind you, it was not a sporadic statement made by me. Each one of the words uttered in the meeting were calibrated. They were discussed before we addressed the press conference. And I was duly authorized by my other three colleagues to make those statements. It's not that I just blurted out sporadically there. No. Democracy as envisaged by the Indian Constitution looked at the judiciary as some kind of an impartial arbiter between the state and the citizen. Apart from the traditional function of the judiciary as an adjudicator of private disputes, the role of the judiciary in this higher constitutional judiciary in this country, as designed by the Constitution, is that it has an obligation, it has a duty, it has the jurisdiction to adjudicate disputes arising between the citizen and the state, the subject and the states. In fact, a jurist took an objection when I used the word subject. I deliberately used it because it's a jurisprudentially approved expression. See, the Indian Constitution and the Indian laws not only regulate the lives of all the citizens, those who are not citizens, foreigners, who come here to stay temporarily for a short period of time, either on a job or even as a tourist, they are also subject to Indian laws to a certain extent. For example, criminal law, nobody is an exception. If a foreigner comes here and commits a murder, he is not a citizen. Can he get away with it? He is still a subject. When I use this word, a very famous jurist in this country, in one of my judgments, took an objection that Justice Chelameswar reduces. Well, if you don't understand the context in which I used it, I can't help it. That's a different matter. That is the sense in which I use this. And if that is the role, that is the important role assigned to the constitutional courts of this country, they are expected to be absolutely impartial and transparent in their dealings with the cases where particularly the state is a party. See, it's easy to be impartial in a 4-acre land dispute between a joint family property, you don't know them and the stakes are too low, you have no interest, you can be absolute saint and decide according to your own wisdom or lack of it. But when the state is on one side, all kinds of considerations crop in. Please remember the fact, ultimately, judges are appointed by the state. Judges' salaries are paid by the state, not to talk about post-retirement cakes. So therefore, some amount of interface between the state and the judges, the judiciary, is unavoidable. That's what I wrote in the NJIC judgment. To believe that in a democracy the elected government should have no say at all in the appointment of judges is something which I can't understand as a student of constitutional law. But to what extent it can go is a different question. To say that the executive will not have a say in the matter, as a student of constitutional law, I am still not able to understand that statement. Well, that's anyway that the law declared by the court, we are bound by it. But the point is, how the state should exercise that power, how should it wield that power, in what manner should it exercise, to what limited extent? When the constitution was framed, the framers of the constitution knew these problems. After all, they were men and women of great experience. They knew history, they knew their country, their society, its problems. And the history of democracy in the world, the need to have an independent judiciary, they designed a scheme saying that since ultimately the government is responsible for people, they get elected, they should have the power. But that power is once again qualified by imposing an obligation to consult the judiciary, the Chief Justice of India. That is the text of the Constitution. Now, while interpreting the expression text of the Constitution, the Chief Justice of India, subsequently in the second judge's case, a 9-judge bench of the Supreme Court laid down, looking at various factors and various earlier practices, that it's not enough to consult only the Chief Justice of India, but a collegium of a certain number of judges, because the composition of the collegium varies depending upon the purpose. It is an elevation to the High Court, and the number of the judges is the first three. If the Supreme Court, first five. It is a case of transfer of 5 judges. You know, therefore, the collegium composition varies depending on the purpose for which it is sitting. That's the interpretation placed by the Supreme Court, 9-judge bench. That is the law of the land. Now, whether such a system requires a modification or not is a matter of opinion. Parliament opined that the system required a modification, introduced the amendment, 99th amendment. NJIC was brought in. It was debated and majority took the opinion. View the amendment is invalid, though I was a dissenter.
Justice Ranjan Gogoi, who is today CJI, had that time revealed that the trigger was
So don't say trigger. He didn't say that. Somebody pestered him. Is it the reason? He said, that's also a reason, he said.
Exactly.
If you recollect, please play it back. It's there on video.
Yeah, you're right.
He didn't say it was the reason.
I correct that. At a prompting by
because, see, after all, the journalist, Ms. Karay is here, he left.
Journalists are equally notorious.
No. See, after all, they are interested in masala. So therefore, everybody was, now. Whether we could have held the press conference one day before or 2 days later, it was our choice, and why it happened is a different matter. I'll disclose it later, that's not the point. But when we handed over the letter, a letter written 2 months prior to it, just try to understand, it's not that particular case or that particular morning something happened, therefore we went.
It's a cumulative thing, a series of political sensitive cases.
Things happened.
So tell me, so much time has elapsed since we've had a change of CJI, you've been in retirement. How do you see things now? Do you think you have the vantage point, look at it from the outside. Do you think the issues that you've raised are being addressed? Are there norms now for assignment of cases, politically sensitive cases? or is it that the five judge bench which decided on the master of the roster case, they have actually set things in the opposite direction?
See, no, what, how do you see the things? I'm not a clairvoyant. I don't know what's going to happen in this country.
Just from the outside. No,
but the point is, as a famous American jurist puts it, about the Constitution, about in the context of the American Constitution, he said it's valid for any constitutional system. He says it's an intentionally incomplete and deliberately open textual document for the participatory evolution of democratic practices. Lawrence Tribe says this. Similarly, any democracy, it's a participatory evolution. How it's going to evolve, it depends upon all the players. The civil society, ultimately, how the civil society is going to react to a particular this thing. Mm-hmm. Now, thing is, there were certain occurrences or practices which in our view were not consistent with the Constitution, both the text and scheme of the Constitution. I think all of you had held and are, some of them are still holding, some of them are still holding, some of them had held responsible positions in governments at various levels. The whole system of democracy is built on a scheme of consultative process from top to bottom, from starting from the highest point of cabinet collective responsibility in the bureaucracy, from the lowest Babu to the chief secretary or the cabinet secretary, whatever the assignment of those responsibilities, you know it better than me. It's a consultative process. Finally, the decision is arrived at. And how is it that this principle of master of the roster excluding everybody for everything? Nobody ever disputed the fact it's a rule of convenience. Say, for example, in the American Supreme Court, this principle would have simply no application because the court would sit en banc. All the nine judges sit to hear each and every case which comes before them. This principle simply is redundant there. The question of allocation of cases doesn't arise there. All the cases go for the full court. It's only in a court like this, where court sits in benches, multiple benches, necessarily somebody has to make the assignment of work. Now, who is that? Well, naturally, the senior most judge is the Chief Justice. So somebody has to do it, therefore, the tradition, the Chief Justice does it. Fair enough, nobody disputed it. But question is, can it be done irrationally? Or should there be some transparent and rational process was the question. And the point, it's a matter of record today, I'll tell you. Matters which were listed before some of us, four of us, were withdrawn at a later point of time and assigned to some other judge.
Without any consultation.
What is the consultation? Simply the matters disappear.
That's what I'm just
It's a matter of Supreme Court's record. Just check up the roster. The
court is emphasizing that. Yeah. Without any consultation.
Not in a word. No. The authority of the Chief Justice to withdraw a case from any one of the benches also is not doubted. He has the power, any Chief Justice, but how you exercise it is a question. You don't exercise it merely. Now, if there is a specific reason, the least expected is a word to the colleague, brother, for this reason I am withdrawing this case. Maybe there is somebody complained, somebody, or, well, whatever is the reason, you have some reason, please do it. Simply withdraw cases which are listed before some judge. Apart from the individual insult to the, now, people said, no, some very learned man said, are these people suspecting the Chief Justice? Well, you can talk anything, we know what happened inside.
Yeah.
When we speak out, well, the comment is, no, it has never happened and you are destroying the institution. When we don't speak out, no, why could they not sit down and discuss the thing and settle the matter? Why should they wash the dirty linen in the market? When do we discuss these matters?
It was a difficult decision for you.
My opening statement was that with no pleasure in my heart we are taking this decision. The press conference.
Interesting. I think when I was talking to you yesterday, you were also pointing out that there could be times when the higher judiciary, anywhere, I'm not talking about India, you cited Abraham Lincoln. So there was a time when there was so much bias in the judiciary there that Abraham Lincoln had to push them back, and he didn't implement some of their
the civil war.
He was trying to implement a liberal agenda, right?
Yeah. See, that's why it is always said there are certain areas traditionally judiciary never entered into. Mm-hmm. Policy areas.
Yeah.
Policy area, because we are not voted to power. Mm-hmm. We don't know what are the finer nuances involved in it. There could be implications of international relations in a particular policy. So therefore, it's basically for the policymaker to... Now, unless there is something in the policy which is plainly inconsistent with the Constitution.
Or violates on the fundamental rights.
That's right.
Yeah, exactly.
Otherwise, merely because it's not a wise... If you believe that the policy of the government is not wise, you don't interfere. Because they'll be answerable to the people in the next election.
So this brings me to a larger question. Today, there is a... civil society, right-thinking people today have one complaint, which is that Supreme Court is ready to intervene in policy issues where it, as you said, may not have expertise, but when it comes to question of rights, when they come to the Supreme Court, fundamental rights, they shy away from taking up those cases. I'll give you one example, CGI, it was a disappointment that for us journalists and many others, that when this matter came to him to strike down criminal defamation, which has been struck down all over most of the world, he said no, the Supreme Court need not take
not
up this. Parliament decided.
Not struck down, but some of the by legislatively
yeah,
legislative
yeah. He said let Parliament do it.
Yeah.
So I mean, we were expecting that the Supreme Court would do it.
Well, a lot of people expect a lot of things.
See, some of the criminal cases against us, the wire would have we could have then gone to court saying.
The point is this. Now, this is the problem exactly I was pointing out. This is a problem inbuilt in the design of the Indian Supreme Court and the way it evolved. If the court sat en bloc, all the judges, of course, this court with 30 judges, 32 perhaps was not in the contemplation of the constitutional framers. It started as a court of 7 judges. Over a period of time, the numbers increased. With the numbers, the volume of the litigation also increased. Nothing is resolved, but that's not the point. But 30 judges sitting as one unit perhaps may not be possible at all. It may not be practicable, this thing. Now, you have different benches, and depend on, for all judges are human beings. They have their own thought process, their own beliefs. Now, you have an expectation the particular judge may not agree with you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if the court sits en bloc, there will be certainty, yes, there is 9 judges, 5 judges agree with you, 4 judges don't agree with you, with your viewpoint. Well, that is the law declared, but that is the arrangement we have made in the constitutional system. If somebody has to decide, we have designed an institution which decides the question. Well, if you don't agree with it, don't agree with it, continue as rating, maybe sometime later. Maybe a different set of judges a generation later might agree with you.
Mm-hmm.
There is a whole idea of a dissenting judgment, isn't it?
So, do you think there has been debate on this in the past?
Hmm.
Again, this comes down to assignment of cases to various benches.
Hmm.
Do you think there should be a system where there should be a constitutional court with maybe whatever 6, 7, 10 judges, and there should be appeals court, So constitutional matters come to, can some administrative arrangement be changed within the present framework without resorting to
it's
again,
possible.
Going to parliament?
It is possible to do it, provided all the stakeholders sit and discuss the matter and take a decision. In fact, a few years back, on one occasion there was, normally I'm sure all of you know, when the Chief Justice of India retires, Prime Minister hosts a dinner at his residence to all the judges of the Supreme Court.
Mm-hmm.
When a new Chief Justice takes over, the Rashtrapati hosts a dinner. They are not only judges, senior bureaucrats and ministers are also invited there. The point is, in one of those dinners in the Prime Minister's residence a few years back, during Mr. Manmohan Singh's tenure. A few senior ministers were there. And I happened to sit in one of those tables where the minister and a very senior bureaucrat and a couple of my own colleagues. And about, if you recollect that judgment where the Supreme Court struck down Section 8, Subsection 4 of the Representation of People Act, which led to the issuance of an ordinance, and the present president of the Congress Party tore up that bill, case, I'm talking about that judgment.
Yeah.
When having dinner, one of the gentlemen, the minister who was sitting with one of the ministers who was sitting with us in the table, he tried to raise the topic saying that Justice Chelameswar, don't you think the something? Then I told him, gentlemen, it's too serious a matter for a dining table conversation. If you think that some reform is required, hold a proper meeting, a proper forum. See, nobody is willing to debate. If a reform, you are saying, suggesting something, then the reform should be preceded by appropriate discussion, deliberation by all the concerned stakeholders. Government is a stakeholder.
Why not civil society? Maybe
civil society? Yes, certainly. Certainly. I was the only judge who said civil society's participation in the judges' selection is welcome.
Sir, I'll ask you this one or two, just one last question before taking it to the audience. One is this backlog problem which media keeps writing about for the last 20 years, we've been saying. Now it has reached some enormous proportions, 3.3 crore of total backlog cases.
The country, not in the Supreme Court, the whole country.
Not SC.
Supreme Court is about 50,000.
Yeah. So, Supreme Court is about 58,000, High Court is about 43 lakhs.
Allahabad High Court alone has close to a million cases pending.
So, have you, in the course of your your stay in the Supreme Court, have you discussed how to deal with the supply problem? How to supply more courts, more judges?
Discuss with whom?
Okay.
No, I'm serious. Discuss with whom? See.
First amongst yourselves and then with law minister. Then.
No, law ministers was a very occasion for me to discuss.
I'll tell you something.
Notwithstanding the grand assertion about that master of the roaster business, if a discussion to things like this is to be done, the initiative must start there. Nobody ever took the initiative. Nobody ever called for a discussion on this. On the other hand, it was a bench of which I presided over. We issued certain, what happened, one of those matters which came from Allahabad. Somebody was convicted for an offence under 302, the appeal is pending. And he is in jail for almost 10 years, the appeal is not getting listed. The matter came before us. And all of us know, at least the system we know, some of these high courts, these matters spent for decades.
Yeah.
For various reasons, of course. There is no point in blaming individual institutions or individuals in this matter. The reasons are too many, it requires a detailed analysis. But Allahabad is a big, UP is a big state, huge population of 20 crores and the number of judges, and all these reasons. Now, when we saw this, we thought something is required to be done. We initiated, on the judicial side, we initiated a process. We called for a report from the High Court, then we appointed an amicus curiae to make suggestions to how to get over this problem. And I'm told now the scope of that inquiry is enlarged by this current bench, whichever is hearing the matter. They extended it to other high courts also, they called for information. So, but some attempt is being made, whatever is within our reach. Now, see, except, I'll tell you one anecdote. I was the Chief Justice of Kerala before I reached the Supreme Court. For about 18 months I was there. One of those days, some event connected with the courts, I was there as Chief Justice, I was there in the program. The then Law Minister, incidentally, he happened to be the Deputy Chief Minister of the state at that point of time. He was also there in the program. and some inauguration or some new court building or whatever it was. The inevitable accusation came at the end of the thing, saying that of course we have done this, we have a new building, we have, the government was generous enough to grant so much of money, new building, new court, all kinds of tamasha. And the inevitable accusation, but unfortunately courts take long time to decide the issues. I appeal to the Chief Justice to take measures to expedite the judicial process. So I had to directly respond. It's a public forum, people were watching me. So then in my turn I told Mr. So-and-so, Mr. Minister, I don't want to name the person, Mr. Minister, just take the figures. What was the total number of manpower employed by your state in 1955 when the state of Kerala came into existence in the bureaucracy, starting from the chief secretary to the last clerk? And what was the population of Kerala at that point of time? And what was the total number of judicial officers, starting from the chief justice to the last magistrate? And take the current figures, compare, what is the ratio? Then the answer, of course, I'm sure all of you must be knowing, the budgetary allocation in any state in favor of judiciary does not exceed 2%. Some states it's as low as 0.75% of the budget, total budget outlay.
Yeah.
But the sanctioning of more money itself will not directly solve the problem. There are various other factors which it requires a whole debate. I can talk about it for days together. But then the starting point is that.
So there's a quality problem and a quantity
problem. So many things. Yeah. Now, the first thing is this. See, the number of courts are not sufficient. What was the Indian population in 1950? About 40 crores. And what is our population today? And how are we going to handle this? Plus the number of appeals available in this country. In no other country, this many appeals are available. For example, a simple matter like 138 Negotiable Instruments Act. Mm. From the magistrate to the district court to the high court, eventually people land up in the Supreme Court. And this four-tier scrutiny of a simple matter like this, I don't think is really necessary. If it is really necessary, there is something radically wrong with the efficiency of the system at every level. Then therefore discord, something has to be done. It requires some serious debate about it.
Generally, I think the judgeable developing countries 5 times more than India.
Definitely.
At least
sometimes some of these countries are the percentage is much higher.
To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.